Yeah.
Excellent.
Welcome, everyone. Thank you for joining us for today's webinar, How Small Firms Can Evolve in the COVID-19 Environment. My name is Monica Förster, and I'm the chair of the IFAX Small and Medium Practice Advisory Group. I'm also managing my own SMP in Brazil. Today, I will be serving as the moderator of this 75-minute webinar. Indeed, it's great to know that we have about 1,600 participants all around the world watching our webinar today. Before we get started, I would like to go over a few items so you know how to participate in today's event. You have the opportunity to submit text questions to today's panel's members by typing your questions into the Q&A box in your Zoom control panel. So any questions, any comments, please write down in the Q&A box. You may send in your questions at any time during the webinar. We will collect this and hope to address many of them at the end. This session is being recorded and will be posted in the IFAC Knowledge Gateway. As you are aware, COVID-19 has had a significant impact on organizations of all sizes, the global economy, and how we operate professionally and manage our personal lives. Many are still making adjustments, and the way firms function and manage our most important resource, people, has likely changed forever. The recovery of SMEs will be critical for economies to get back to sustain growth. These extraordinary circumstances also offer small and medium-sized practices, the SMPs, significant opportunities to adapt and service a rapidly changing world. SMPs often have close and long-standing relationships with their SME clients, which is based on a high level of trust. We're going to use the recently launched IFAC Practice Transformation Action Plan, a roadmap to the future, as a basis for discussion about the new normal and how firms can evolve in this environment and step further into the role of trusted advisor. This morning, I'm delighted to be joined with a distinguished panel, Mr. George Willey. George is the managing partner of Baird Smith & Co. with over 40 years of experience, specializing in audit of healthcare, government, and not-for-profit entities. He has served in numerous leadership positions within the AICPA for many years. We also have Mr. Tom Hood. Tom has been the CEO of Maryland Association of CPA and Business Leader Institute, BLI, for 22 years. Tom is considered one of the most influential leaders in the global accountancy profession. And Mr. Mike Mabaya. Mike has close to 20 years of experience in public practice and is currently the leader partner of Mabaya and Associates, which is a highly reputed mid-size accounting practice in Kenya. Our panel members will share with you their thoughts and practical insights about steps firms can take today. As a short background to our discussion, Mr. George Willey will provide an overview of the IFAC Practice Transformation Action Plan. So without further ado, please welcome George Willey.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and thank you for your leadership, and thank you for all for attending this webinar. The Chair has spoken to the S&P Group's determination to bring transformation in practice and our future together. We know that we will have to embrace change. We know that transformation will not wait. We are not speaking about the speed or certainty. The only certainty that we should have is the priority that we look forward to. We are certain of transformation. We're certain that we will not go back to where we were before COVID. Speed and transformation has changed our certainty. Technology, there is an explosion, and which we'll cover more in detail. And Mike will speak more to that later on. We are creating a new world, new opportunities for our profession. With respect to talent management, I ask that you remember two things. Focus on your people, focus on your team, and do the best you can to keep those that are capable. You're going to need them in the future. Next slide.
Next slide.
Next slide.
Okay. Yeah, Josh, you are on.
I'm good. Next slide. Huh? We will catch up. Let's speak about technology and our embrace for technology. Let's speak about how we change the landscape. What is it that we are seeing? How do we adopt the cloud? How do we involve our clients in technology decisions? And how do we create and the support of internal technology consultant? We have to know who we are, what we are capable of. We need to look outwardly. What is the changing landscape is, what is it going to be? All technology is not for everyone. What are our capabilities? What are the needs of our clients? That is what we should be looking at. We need to understand that what we do, what we sell, our brand is what attracts potential staff. It is what we do and who we serve that will attract potential staff. And in these days, no young professional wants to go to a firm that is not technologically advanced, utilizing tools that are capable of changing the way our clients work and our efficiency that we deliver. But we must align with our strategy on a long-term basis. And I would be remiss if I didn't say that everything cannot be long-term. Some have to be adjusted as things change. But as we talk about our strategy, we need to consider the clients we serve. What is it that we think we will be able to do? What is the expertise that we have? What will be the clients that we serve? And we must match our needs, our determination, of course, our cash ability, but more importantly, how sensitive is our clients to what we're trying to do? Will their systems mesh with ours? Do we have the capability of bringing their system to be compatible with what we are trying to accomplish? These are the things about technology. It's not a great thing about we just adopt and buy and buy and buy. Is it feasible? What is the strategy? What is the staff involvement? In addition, clients need to know that they are embraced and where we're going. They need to understand that we have taken their concerns in consideration as we speak to technology. And yes, the cloud is there. But let's speak about quickly about some of the important things about the cloud. It is the future. It is a change. But so many clients, in their haste to get to the cloud as a result of COVID and the stay at home and remote, that they do not make the proper choices and the efficient moves. We have an opportunity to be there for our clients to see that they move to the cloud in a responsible, effective, and efficient way that makes our systems compatible, our staff happy, and we can work with their people on an ongoing basis without interruption. Support an internal technology champion. And what do I know about it? What do I mean by that? So many times in the olden days, all the decisions were made at the top. And we tell our staff, this is what we're going to do. Did we invite them in? Did we ask them, what do you see? What are your friends doing? What are they working on? How are their clients relating to this particular piece of software? Does it work? They will feel enabled. They will be part of our solutions rather than some directive coming from a high saying, this is what we're going to do. Long-term involvement. Yes, AI is around, but please keep in mind cybersecurity risk. These are areas in which we as accountants and advisors can look to and expect our clients to seek our assistance. And not only seek our assistance, we should be proactive enough to be speaking to our clients saying, here is what we need, here's what we're doing, and here is what a young senior or a young consultant can help you with, and there's much more symmetry between your team and our team. Next slide. How do we evolve? And I may not go in the order in which you see it on your screen because there are some issues here that I think are so critical. And I thank the team for looking at these issues as they have come up. Change is not static. It's ongoing. We need to invest in our time, our staff time, to remain current. But also, being on an ongoing learning development process means that we must be aware of competition. Do not be mistaken that COVID is going to leave us the way we are and we're not going to, be, chances are, the stronger will survive. That's what we at S&P Advisory Committee are looking at. We are looking at how our members can survive. How can we enable our clients to survive? But it requires continuous learning, continuous development, and an investment, not for now, but in the future, in what we do, how we think. I spoke earlier on of everything coming from the top and handing down. Recruitment, retention will always be at the top issue for our profession. And what we have found is that if we get our staff involved, if we get them to speak to us, we cut out this hierarchical, but when we are calling this top-down issue, if we get them to collaborate, working in teams, understanding what our priorities are and where our future lies, that is what we should be doing. We speak somewhere some years ago where we recognized the changes in the marketplace, the transformation of our profession. We did a poll, we did a survey, a global poll, and we said, what is important to the survival of firms? Same issues came back, retention, staffing, whatever. But on one item that came up, what is our brand? What is our brand? That is what evolution means. is to be known for what you can do best, the clients you serve, and the comfort in which your staff and team will work. Introducing flex time. Let's get over it. Working from home, remote learning, remote work, all of that, they are here to stay. How best can we harness the resources of these young professionals? We're never going to get them to come back to the office every day. We're going to get rotational teams where there is a time when we are understanding that that coffee break, that break at the water cooler will still be in place. But we're never going to get a full floor of staff milling around working. We can serve our clients with clarity, with purpose, and be attentive to what their needs are in the way we are. We're convinced greater collaboration will take place. Recruitment. Much has changed in the past 20 years when we decided that we had to put on this great show and we have young folks line up at the table and go through this contest. Technology has taken care of a lot of that before. The talent search will still be critical. But as SMP, we have to define ourselves. I spoke earlier of our brand. What is it that we're known for? What is our expertise? We cannot be all things to all people. The teens and young potential members want to know, are you technologically involved? Are you technologically advanced? Are the clients that you serve, are they adapting to technology? And how best they can advance themselves? We learned some time ago that dollars did not constitute the main attraction to that recruit. We learned that individuals join a firm for different reasons. What they see, how they feel, your brand, the clients you serve, and that overall reputation of how well do you take care of your people. That is what we do. Techniques aside, at the end of the day, what is it that we tell our people that there's a future, there's a moving on up, there's a desire for you to be the best you can be. That's the overall technique. Next slide, please. There is so much discussion, and COVID, for all its evil pandemic, has moved the issue of what it is that our clients want, how best can we serve them, and what should we be looking at? And the question is, we're going to give up compliance. No, we're not going to give up compliance. There's always be the need for compliance, assurance, and auditing. But times have changed. Times have required us, now require us, anticipate our clients' needs. Focus on how can we help them manage their cash flow? How can we help them to get to a new niche? And do we have the expertise to service them in that new niche? What are the strategies? Expertise. Being able to deliver what is it you promise. Having the expertise to be efficient and to be effective. Yes, we'll talk about what is it that we have to do. Will we be able to, and we'll get to that, be able to give out, throw away our timesheets? That's not what we're talking about. And I know there is a bullet which speaks to niche market. Yes, we do. The only way we're going to be able to compete is to be able to determine and to satisfy the market that we possess the type of expertise that's equivalent or equal and greater than another firm. But I beg you, do not promise more than you can deliver. Do not become an expert with one client or one opportunity to have served in a particular market. Specialization may be the wave of the future, but let's be careful that we're specialists in what we're capable of developing. I believe in networks and associations. I do believe that they add value. So many smaller firms get to learn, and I use it very seriously. Anyone who is in a situation who there are things going on that you did not know and you did not learn something from being part of that group, we need to think about what we do. There are things, there are associations where associations will help us in marketing or working with a particular client because we know we have the backup, the resources that we can tell that client that we have. And in a changing world for an SMP to believe that we have the knowledge of all that is happening, that's some thinking. No, you do not. What you do have is the desire, the objectivity, the determination to serve. But in many instances, you need the resources and the backup to allow you to deliver the services that you're capable of. Changes create opportunities. And it is our job to take care of these opportunities if we have the wherewithal to make it happen. Yes, we must anticipate our clients' needs, but determine how best we can fill. And being a part of an association, if we by ourselves cannot fill all the needs of a particular client, our alliances will allow us to keep that client and to serve with efficiency and effectiveness. In these days, in these times, we gotta think about business continuity, bankruptcies, niches for our own clients, how best we can advise them. What is it that the times present to us that we can be more strategic advisors? We have one thing going for us from the beginning and with it being post-COVID, the issue of trust. We're the trusted advisors, and that's where we belong. Evolving means that the future is here. The pandemic will end. Our profession will survive. Practice transformation is about adopting, adjusting to change itself. The future is about change and how we harness change. S&P Advisory Group has been a constant. Anticipating change, providing guidance and the tools to help SMPs and their clients move forward. We believe evolving and operating and building services through change, as we see in our practice guide or practice management and the many tools that we provide, should become a part of your change, transformation to the future. Thank you, Madam Chair. Sir Tom, please.
George, thank you.
Yes. Yep.
All right. Well, hello, everyone out there from IFAC. And it's an honor to be here with this group. In fact, it was just over 3 years, George and Madam Chair Monica and Mike, that I was up in New York with all of you. And it's just been fascinating to see how much work you've done. This practice transformation guide truly is remarkable. And I want all of you out there to be just thinking for a second about, I call it putting your opportunity antennas up. So while we're in the midst of all this crisis, I think there's also a whole lot of opportunity. And that's what I think this panel and this guide is here to help you do. Now, 5 years ago, we talked about five major trends. And in fact, we would say that many of those have moved, but maybe not as fast as we all thought. And so I want you to think for a moment about tectonic plates, those slow moving plates under the Earth's surface. Most of the time we don't even notice or see it. At other times they come together, press up against each other, and the pressure builds and builds until there's a dramatic tectonic shift, an earthquake. And I think that's what we've all experienced with this COVID situation. On the Richter scale, it was off the charts. And the aftershocks will continue to reverberate probably for years. And that's what this chart is going to talk about. So the size, scope, and speed of this crisis makes it more dangerous, which says that imagining a new normal almost seems inadequate. I prefer to use the McKinsey term recently coined as the next normal. This is meant to reframe our thinking and change our paradigms from back to business as usual to what's the next normal going to be like. And with all that's happened, with all that's still happening, many firms out there are busier than ever. But if we're not careful, if we don't manage to look ahead, like IFAC is advising here, and devise the right long-term strategies for success, there's a real risk for us and our organizations and the global economy, which relies on us, to busy ourselves out of business. So we've been thinking about this, and we think there are five distinct stages that we're going to be navigating through this COVID storm. And they are resolve. That was the first stage when we got the shock and we had to figure out how to just survive. Then we moved to what I call relief and resilience. Around the world, many countries were offering relief packages that accountants and CPAs had to do in their own areas to help small businesses and mid-sized businesses. And then if not, you had to have the resilience to make it through and help your clients make it through. Then we move to what we call the reopening phase. Actually, in the United States, we're just about there, although some states are actually moving backwards. But that's where we would all be trying to get to, right? When we actually can come back to some form of business. It won't be like it was before, but we are beginning to see that. Now, I think shortly after that, we're going to have to start reimagining what this next normal might start to look like. Based on all the things we learned through reopening, and you watch what your clients are doing and where innovation is happening, and then start to help them and you reimagine new services, how you can help them move forward through this even faster. And I think once we get through, I call that the fog of uncertainty, as you start to see a little bit further ahead and we see how businesses might be starting to shape, I think we're gonna move to what we would call a redefine and reinvent stage, where it's going to be critical, again, for you all to redefine and reinvent the services that you can provide your clients by looking at how they need to redefine and reinvent their own businesses. Now, underneath all that, we think there's three new imperative skills that will dominate our ability to innovate and navigate these turbulent times. And they are, and George, you referred to it, anticipation. What can you actually anticipate in future trends and emerging issues versus what you can't? Agility, for those things that you can't anticipate, you're going to have to be able to react quickly and make decisions faster. And then finally is adaptation. We're all going to have to learn, unlearn, and relearn new skills and adapt to the emerging world that begins to come after that. And that's what I think is going to happen. And by the way, this practice transformation guide roadmap is there for you to start making actions today to help you thrive through these next few phases. And I think that's where we're going to be coming back as a panel to talk through some of these issues. So I think I hand it back to our chair, Monica.
Thanks, Tom. Thank you very much, George and Tom. This was a very interesting presentation. We'll now run through two poll questions based on what we just heard by George and Tom. This will be quick poll questions only to have a reference on how is the reaction of the audience on this topic. So Jasmine, let's please run the poll. It will appear in front of your screen right now. So we do have two questions to be quickly answered by you. We'll have about 2 minutes to answer these questions, and we will discuss further based on the results. The first question is in reference to the slide from Tom. At which stage of the curve are you currently in? So are you in the stage of resolve, relieve, and resilience? Reopen, reimagine, or redefine and reinvent? The second question is, which issue apart from COVID-19 do you think will impact the accountancy profession the most in the next 12 months? New technology and need for digital skills, attractiveness to future students and talent retention, changing regulations and standard, trust and credibility, and ability to pivot to cater to the new market needs, changing the demands. Please answer these two poll questions in order our speakers should discuss further on these topics. So we have 1 more minute to get the audience answers.
Monica, it's Chris. Just interested if the panel have any initial remarks, observations from the results here. It seems that most are in the reopen phase, and perhaps no surprise that new technologies and need for digital skills is coming through strongly from the majority in terms of the issue that's going to impact the panelists the most in the next 12 months.
Thanks, Chris. Yeah, it's something that we understand. We certainly will have different perspectives depending on the region of the respondents and on the profile of the firms and of the practitioners. But it's expected to hear something on that line. So 30 more seconds. Thank you, Jasmine. Now we can share the results. Here we have. So on poll question one, in reference to Tom's slide, at which stage of the curve are you currently in? Majority, 43%, is in phase of reopening. However, we do have significant percentage of relief and resilience and also on reimagine. On the second question, as Chris just mentioned, a significant huge percentage of new technology and need for digital skills. And the technologies is something that we consider as being the urgent future. And with all this pandemic situation, the future became the today. So it's not surprising to see this answer. We also have a high rate on the ability to pivot to cater to new market needs. So I'll open again to Tom, George, and Mike, especially Tom, on your thoughts on this answers of the poll. Over to you.
Yeah, Monica, thank you. So I would have expected most of us in the world, just from the things I've been reading, are probably in that reopen. It's interesting to see about 20% of you in the reimagine phase. That's encouraging. And I think that's an opportunity to really use the practice transformation action plan to help jumpstart or accelerate those things that you might be doing to help clients as they reimagine. Those of you in the resolve, you're early on in, and I would just say, hang in there and stick with it. Again, you could get an early start on all of this, knowing where everyone else is going. Relief and resilience, there's even, again, that one's based on a lot of these stimulus packages that are coming out from different countries. That's what I would say there. Obviously, in the issues from the most pressing issues, I think you're right on spots. Clearly, technology and digital skills, digital transformation, number one by far. And I love the idea of pivoting to cater to new market needs. That's telling me that you're watching your client base from that perspective. I'd love to hear what you all think. What do you think about these results and kind of where those pieces look like on that chart? Mike, how about you? What's happening? Where do you think?
I would like to pinpoint probably these stages might not necessarily be concurrent, because you might have the reopen stage. While you're reopening, there are people who are reimagining, there are people who are redefining and reinventing themselves. Then after redefining yourself, you can go back to reimagining and try and see which kind of services can we reopen, how are we gonna restructure them. So it's not necessarily that the service, that this would be concurrent, or it's not necessarily that each particular area will take 2 or 3 months. It could vary according to the various needs of the firm or the various circumstances that you find yourself in. But what is very clear is that more than ever before, we need to constantly be relooking at the business, relooking at the environment, relooking at what it is that we are offering. So you are studying the environment just as much as you're studying probably the standards that you use in accounting.
Yeah. Monica, how about you? What's your thoughts around this?
Yes, certainly it depends on the situation of the country to see the stage of the curve we are. So I can see different perspectives. Mike brought a very important point, that is, we might have different situations. For example, at the same time that we need to be focusing on reopening, we have a feeling of relief, because it seems as okay, this crazy times have caused an impact on us and we need to change that. But at the same time, we need already to think on how will we react and what will we do from now on? So it's a kind of a mix of feelings that probably, and the stage are those feelings that are happening at the same time. George, would you have any specific point or perspective on that?
Madam Chair, I thought it was a very interesting response. But for me, I think that you have to group reopening, reimagining, and redefining together. And it depends on the maturity of the firm, the history of the firm, its clientele, its staffing. Because as I think of reopening, as I said, we're not ever going back to how we used to operate. We're never going back to who is going to be at home or if we're going to be at home. And the question is, how do we get our clients, in my mind, to think the same way we're on this curve that Tom has presented, which I think is rather amazing. And until we get to understanding how we're going to reimagine, it will be difficult to redefine and reinvent, because it's an ongoing process, just along a spectrum that we're just looking at constantly. And as I said earlier on, we cannot be mindless or not mindful of competition, because as we stay on one section of that curve, others are moving either below or above. And I think it's, I love this discussion, Tom, and Mike, I agree with you. It requires so many other considerations.
Thanks, George. I would like now to start our panel discussion. We have received a question, which I will first ask for Tom's reflection on. Tom, how can small firms embrace change, and what steps should they take to be resilient and service clients in the current environment?
I think that I would say first thing is use the IFAC practice transformation guide. I think those four pieces there, right? Number one, embrace change, leverage technology, focus on talent management, and evolve your firm operating model. For you would be to pick one that you think will have the biggest impact in the shortest amount of time. Now, if you're not already to the cloud, as you heard George present, that might be your first step. You've got to be on the cloud to be able to transact, and you need to help your clients get on the cloud so that they can transact in this, you know, COVID world. Whatever stage of that you're in, I think we're seeing touchless, cashless, right? All kinds of e-commerce. That's an essential, I think. So I would start there if you're not already there from that perspective. And back to the talent thing, I love what George said about you can also engage your people to try to start finding some of those solutions. So I would say the one trend that we know is digital transformation has now accelerated dramatically, just like the work from home, right? It was like everybody flipped the switch and we're all, boom, working from home. So that's what I would be I would start there. Transformation action plan helps you. What do you all think about that? What would you say?
Yeah, I would touch on the area of attitude. We've got to be ready to change. We have to be very nimble in how it is that we're willing to adopt, we're willing to change, we're willing to transform our lives so that we're able to serve our clients better. And if you look at the traditional audit firm structure, what COVID has done is to throw that all over the place so that we no longer have a structure. It is the firms that are nimble, the firms that are able to be fluid enough to move to the situation, to react to the situation. Those are the firms which are able to be able to best suit their clients, be able to adapt to what the clients are going through. And that is something that we hope a lot of the SMPs will be very strong at in terms of adapting, becoming quick to change and becoming quick to realize what their clients are going through and be able to think and look at solutions which can come through for the clients. So an attitude shift so that we are no longer as rigid as we used to be or no longer as structured as we used to be, but now really focusing on solutions. And whichever section those solutions come from, that is something we have to adapt very quickly to, knowing that yesterday's solutions might not be tomorrow's solutions. So as audit firms, as practitioners, we really need to be nimble, not stick to the textbooks like we've done for many years, be able to adapt and adapt quickly.
Mike, I could not agree with you more. I just believe, and I think Tom touched on it, but all through this, we need to remember the most critical part of our operations, our staff, our members. And I often tell folks in the last couple of months, do the best you can to keep those good young team members. You're going to need them. Those are the people that your clients knew before this all started. And that continuity, not only in you, but in the people who have served them in the past, will be very, very important. Change does not mean throwing out everything. It means that the times have presented us with the different opportunities, different challenges, and we are supposed to develop the tools to be a part of this new world. So I just think that we got to be very careful of not understanding what brought us. Objectivity, being trusted advisors, and being able to anticipate what our clients need and provide them with the information. Just be alert to what is moving around us. And that's the reason why I stress so much the issue of associations. Things are moving in different quarters. People are doing different things differently. And if we can embrace some of those matters, we can be that much better for our clients and for our staff.
Thank you very much. These were very interesting points, and we know that the challenges probably will continue and will be needing to readapt and face that quicker than we expected and in a different way than we expected. Next question, I'm going to ask Mike first. Mike, how should firms focus on staff, and what advice can you share for firms operating virtually?
Yeah, one of the things we are looking at right now, when you're hiring, when you're bringing in staff, when you look at your staff complement, it's no longer the technical skills that will be the key to success. Technical skills will be a big part of it, but increasingly, it's those soft skills that are coming into play. Are they able to use technology quickly? Are they good communicators with the clients? Are they able to listen to what the client is stating as his problem and understanding that problem and being able to provide solutions to that? So we're finding that we are shifting away from having people who are predominantly very knowledgeable in accounting only, to kind of starting to get a mixed bag of skills. Your computer skills might be at the moment just as important as your accounting skills. Your communication skills at the moment could be equally important to your accounting skills. And just the ability to motivate people, the ability to tell your client, look, don't worry, it's gonna be all right, giving them a hope for the future could just be a kind of skill that in the past accountants have not been renowned too well for. It's something that we will overnight have to develop those skills, be better communicators, be better listeners, and look beyond the balance sheet or the statement of financial position. Look beyond what the profit is for the year and start seeing what are those areas which the clients are fearing? What does the future look like? So that we have somebody who's predicting in the next 3 months, in the next 6 months, this is what I think the environment will be like. So therefore, I would say the workplace kind of requires people who are a little bit more broader than what we used to look for before, which was technical competence. Now we're looking for other skills which will be able to enhance the workplace and to enhance the client's outlook.
Mike, in the previous slide or the previous questions, I think the overwhelming response dealt with technology. But when if I were to ask me, I would say all four items should have been, or all five should have been in the mix. I just believe that attractiveness of future students and of for digital skills, very, very important. Technology by itself, we can adapt all we want, but the technological skills are those kids who are bent on being part of this digital revolution, coming out of college with that feeling, I think are so much critical to our survival. Regulations and standards are going to have an impact, much more than we actually believe. And it's going to have an impact because the standards that we now operate under, the question is, how do you do it? For example, how are you going to audit effectively and appropriately and properly and everything else in a new post-COVID world? Those standards will have to be looked at, new standards will have to be changed, and how effectively we as a just auditors be able to adapt and make the standards work.
And probably just to add on to that, George, the laws are changing, especially with regard to human resource. COVID has come and has sent all employees have been asked to work from home. This was not something that the laws which are available in the various countries had anticipated. So therefore now you find that then we are looking at a brand new environment, an environment which was totally unprecedented. So what happens now when you ask employees to work from home? A court in Switzerland, I've just seen, has ruled that if an employee works from home, the employer should pay part of his rent because he's working from the house. So these are things which even the laws were not ready for COVID. So it is an amazing time for transformation. And that gap, that opportunity gives us a chance to innovate without being fearful of what the law says. So we can actually push the needle in that direction or in whichever direction we'd like, so that we are able to become a lot more effective, a lot more efficient in that regard right now before the lawmakers come and catch up with us.
I love your the points that you all have been making this morning. I mean, I would say a couple things. I think it was you, Mike, that said the mindset, right? The attitude. I think mindset is number one, by the way. I think you have to have we call it a future-ready mindset to be ready to move your firm and your people through this journey. I think the other thing, I think, George, you said this, that we have to do all of this simultaneously. Just like the points on the curve, Monica, you pointed out, they're not all sequential. Some of them are going to happen concurrently. And in fact, if you're smart, you might accelerate your movement into some of those to help you and your clients. So I just love the conversation here. Again, I'm going to point back, almost all those key concepts are in the Practice Transformation Guide. I want to applaud you all for a really good document.
Thank you very much, Tom. Indeed, the purpose is exactly that, is to allow practitioners and SMPs to face all these challenges, all this future that is already here, and all that importance of the profession that we need to keep it so high level, so important at the same time that we see change of minds in the younger generation. George brought it so well in relation to how to deal and how to stimulate our members. And on that sense, I want to bring one of the questions that came on the Q&A, which states on the surprise on the low level of attractiveness to future students and talent retention work. So I open that question first to George, but then to Tom and Mike also. Why do you think this was rated so low?
Because I very good question, man. It was a question that bothered me too. But then I said, perhaps with my years in this business, perhaps I see things too old fashioned. I believe it is as equally important as technology. There is a technological explosion. We agree to that. But for example, here in the United States, we're looking at what should a CPA exam be in developing the skills or getting young folks to look at the skills that they actually need to be in the market going forward. And I think it is an area for all the jurisdictions to be very conscious of. What will it take? What is the basis? What is the grounding that we present our students with so they can be of value in the new world? And I was somewhat taken back by it, but I think technology, and especially with what's going on, everything being virtual, I think technology will assume that role. But I ask everyone, please be mindful of those who will be using the technology and who will be serving the clients.
I would say, I mean, there's been a great debate for a long time. Do you hire for knowledge or do you hire for aptitude? And what the recent past has shown us is that aptitude is what you should be looking for. Because yesterday's knowledge is no longer today's knowledge. If you look at the standards, they keep evolving every so year. There are a lot of changes that come through in the standards. So if you have the correct aptitude, you will be able to get the new knowledge, you'll be able to learn the new knowledge, you'll be able to unlearn the old things. So therefore, I would say the aptitude, the enthusiasm that you have for knowledge, the enthusiasm that you have for learning, that is something which I would be looking for in the students coming through. How eager are you to be the top of your profession? I think if the aptitude is right, I'm not too worried about the knowledge. That is something that you can always get through, even in your older years. But aptitude, that's a little bit harder to work on. And that's the area where I think the students, just that ability to be willing to be the best at what it is that they are, that's something I would emphasize on.
Okay, George.
You're in charge, Sir Tom. You know that.
Yeah. My quick answer would be, Monica, because I've been thinking about this too, and I'm equally as frustrated by that weighting of that answer. But I think most of us, just looking at where they were on the curve, most practitioners, even globally, are still in more of a survive and sustainability mode. And I think they just can't think farther enough ahead about future workforce and interns. The associations are trying to take care of that temporarily while we're in this transition. But I think it's due to a transition. I hope they come out of the other side of it and that score would go up. Go ahead, George.
No, I was going to be a crazy differential here. I love Mike's aptitude matter. And I love that kid who is very anxious to learn. I love that kid who has enthusiasm. But I want that kid who comes in there with a grounded understanding and a knowledge of what it is to serve a client. And perhaps one way to say that the pace at which we're going, there may be not enough time to teach. And then with that point, I agree with you on that. We're going to have to step back to teach. But we want to have that caliber, that talent, that grounding, that overall body of knowledge coming in that we can take care of.
Thanks, George, Mike, and Tom. We have a lot of very interesting questions, so I'll try to focus on consolidating them somehow. So we received different questions related to technology, use of ERPs for audit and for services in general. And we received a specific question asking about being trusted advisor and achieving a conflict of interest. So first of all, it's important to reinforce here that when we refer on working or acting as a trusted advisor, obviously that's not on audit clients. On audit clients, we keep all independent. So we are speaking about keeping different types of clients. Some of them will be to audit, in which obviously we won't have any role as trusted advisors, and other clients in which we render other types of services in which we have and we act as trusted advisors, only to keep everybody comfortable on that sense. That's a very important question, a very important comment, and this is something we focus very strongly. But coming back to technology, we received these questions on technology, ERPs, et cetera. We know that it's not only about ERPs. We do have different technology perspectives and scenarios. So we speak about cybersecurity, we speak about AI, we speak about data analytics. Considering all this diversity of needed technologies that firms, SMPs, already needed, and right now in this new normal, need more than ever, which would you consider the key or the urgent aspects, technology aspects, that SMPs should be focusing right now? Because we certainly wouldn't have time nor resources enough to prepare to all these different technologies. So I suggest, Tom, you might start that, and then we would like to hear also Mike and George following on this question.
Monica, so I think I'd go back to the fundamental technology under all that stuff is cloud. Almost all the new cloud systems, ERPs, general ledgers, even audit systems, incorporate machine learning, AI, and data analytics. Number two, I would say, is data analytics. So I think if those two would be where you'd start with, and then you'll get the rest of that probably automatically, or it's easy to go from there and build out on it.
Cybersecurity. Yeah. Cybersecurity is my concern. There is a heightened awareness that in these times, there are those who do not always think properly or legally, seize on opportunities like these or times like these to take advantage of weakened systems. Not only I believe cybersecurity should be an area to be focusing on, but I also think it's an opportunity for SMPs who have the knowledge and expertise to be there with their clients in making certain that controls and safeguards are in place to deal with whatever it is that we're doing. And I agree with you, Tom, that data analytics will be a very critical aspect of what we do and what young professionals would be aspiring to be a part of.
Yeah, and to add on to that, I think that the cloud element is very important because cloud allows us to be on the go. It allows us to work and be mobile and be nimble, be able to work from wherever it is we go. So I think that is critically very important, just as good as cybersecurity is. And I think one other area we need to look at is collaboration. The technology has to be able to make us collaborate with the rest of our team members, because as we said, there is no single person who would have a 360 degree knowledge about every aspect of the business. So we need to be able to collaborate. Our technologies, if they're able to make us collaborate with the client, with our teams, I think that allows us to become a lot more efficient, a lot more useful to the client.
When we speak about technology, and you just mentioned on the topic of cybersecurity, we have another question here. Given the upsurge in cybersecurity risks, what practical steps do you advise practitioners should take to allay fears of clients in guiding and advising them on imperative of adopting cloud accounting services? So, George, what would be your perspective on that?
Yeah, I, good Lord has allowed me to serve in many different places these days. And one of the things that we see at audit committees is how do I know we're safeguarded? And so I caution that not all of us have the expertise to work with cybersecurity, but the first issue that we must be able to identify, what are the risks? Have that individual or that association that can allow us to attach us to the type of vendor or contractor who has been doing and working with small and large clients in adopting the type of safeguards, controls that would, nothing will prevent it, let's be clear. Cybersecurity and the ability for anyone to do something illegal will always be here. It's the preventative measures that are critical. It's preventative and being able to address should it occur or to minimize that particular event from occurring. So it's a mix. Your personal knowledge, your association, your client needs, and understand the transaction that are susceptible to being dealt with in an incorrect manner.
Tom, and how do you think COVID and beyond is impacting the practice transformation program?
I think it's accelerating it. I think it's no question. And all of you out there, I think if there's one thing you can do, it would be get moving now. Don't wait.
Mike, considering all what you refer and what has been discussing here and focusing on staff and on people, as George mentioned, they are the most important asset we have. So we need to care on that. Does this mean in the hiring of staff in the future, firms will have to consider whether the staff's ready to work remotely? Is this something the firm can train staff to do?
Definitely, and this is something which we have to include in our training manuals going forward, so that all the staff members that join either have that capability or we're able to enhance them so that they have that capability to be able to work remotely, to be able to collaborate with their team members remotely, to be able to give in their ideas and listen to their team members from a remote location. So that is something that has to be embedded in the training. It is something that we need to develop, just like the cybersecurity. We need to have the tone at the top. The leadership of the firm must talk about it a lot more often and try to inculcate it so that it becomes a culture of the firm, that this is how we're going to be doing business going forward.
Mike, that's a very, very critical matter for firms. There is the type of technology that is out now there. We see it operating now, where you know when a young person is doing the job. You know when a young person is doing what is supposed to be done. We're going to come to some regulatory stuff. How much supervision can you be doing? What is it that would be intrusion versus governance? What would it be that you expect? Would 8 hours mean as long as 8 hours? Will it change the way we look at time? Will it change the way we look at a task? If you complete a task, will it be okay? So these are all considerations that are now being worked through. And the environment that we create, training is okay, but it is, as you may use the word aptitude, is it the persons, not everyone, let's be frank, not everyone is ready for remote working. And it has to be a constant drilling, a constant teaching. You're not working for me. You're not working for the firm. You're working for a client on whom your reputation, your delivery are dependent. So I think it is emerging, it's ongoing. Some firms or some areas are more mature in this regard than others, but it's a step that we all have to be very careful about.
And if you think of the ISQC, I mean, the qualities in the firm, a lot of firms will have to relook at their internal quality review documents and try and inculcate exactly this, so that they ensure that whatever is being put out by the firm has gone through the quality reviews and it meets the standards set out by the firm.
We received a question here on, you don't think that the requirements in programs of education must require knowledge and technology? And this is something that, besides hearing our speakers, certainly, the education will need to be updated, and technology is a key theme to be included. And the modifications, the changes that we need to adopt for this new reality, new normal, call it how we want, need to be incorporated. So the level of communication and of integration between professionals, practitioners, firms, academia needs to be improved more and more. We need to make sure that we are speaking since the beginning of the phases on the same level, on the same wording, on the same focus and purpose. Tom, would you have any comment on that sense on education? And together with that, what do you see as the biggest trends impacting firms today? So focusing on this future.
I think, so the educational piece, in the US, there is a profession-wide in the CPA profession to move the educational model forward in a very different way, which includes a whole lot more technology fundamental into both the learning and into the exam part. So I think that is something that needs to be recognized, and the panel basically acknowledged that. In addition, we're seeing many colleges and universities evolve rather quickly based on demand. So more data analytics, more technologies already being woven in. Many students are double majoring, I think. And that reflects, you know, those top trends. I think you all hit all those major trends. I don't think the trends have changed, Monica. I think the speed of the trends has changed in light of COVID. So all the things we talked about in 2017 are just moving a lot faster. So talent, technology, transforming your firm business model. I mean, really, I would point right back to that practice transformation plan. So I think for all of you out there, pick one thing that you literally could focus on like this week and say, what can we do to get moving? Because you can't wait. If you wait too long, there's going to be a whole lot of people that are passing you by.
Thanks, Tom. Indeed, time runs very quickly, and we are already running to almost the end of our session. So finally, before we close off the session, I would like to invite all my fellow panel members, if there's one key actionable piece of advice that you would like to leave with the audience this morning, what would that be, this advice? Please be short and sweet on that. So first I'd invite Tom to bring the message, then George and Mike.
All right, Monica, thank you. I would say this, it comes from a friend of ours, a futurist that we've been working with, Dan Burris. He says it this way, post-pandemic success will be determined by what you do now, not what you do post-pandemic. So the advice is what I just said, take that practice transformation guide, pick one action you can get moving on like this week and get going.
Thank you, Tom. Now take something from your chart, Tom. Reimagine. Reimagine what we do for ourselves, the changes that we make to ensure our success. We make available and endeavor to do the same for our clients. Take care of your team. Take care of your staff.
I would say, if I was to leave the audience with anything, I'll just say, invent your future now. You have a chance now to invent how it is that you want to work in the next coming days. And this is your opportunity to do so. So take advantage of this time when there's a reset in the world and go out and imagine something that fulfills your dream and lives out your dream.
These indeed are just great messages. And I'm sure that everyone who's listening to us will think about it and will try to apply that in their professional lives from now on. Just to let our audience know, the recording will be available as soon as possible, but not later than next Monday. And we know that we received a lot of different questions that we wouldn't have time to address all here, but we'll take note on this topics, and we'll be focusing also on the important topics discussed here for future Gateway articles and materials, and also for further discussions at our group. So thank you very much on these questions. As final remarks, let me also take this opportunity to highlight that IFAC has a vast array of resources and publications available to support practitioners. These are available on the IFAC Knowledge Gateway and includes a dedicated webpage on practice transformation, featuring examples and case studies, as well as the comprehensive guide to practice management, which covers a number of the topics we discussed today, including managing staff, leveraging technology, and strategic planning. If you have questions that we were unable to get to today, that happens, I just refer, you might also contact us at gateway@ifac.org. We will also post a recording of this webinar on the IFAC Knowledge Gateway soon. On behalf of IFAC, the members of the IFAC S&P Advisory Group, and our honored guest, Mr. Tom Hood, we want to thank you all for your participation, Don't forget to fill in the feedback form, which you'll be receiving immediately after this webinar. You'll only need to click continue when you receive the prompt to fill up the feedback form. With that, have a great rest of your day. Stay safe, take care. Thanks all for our fellow speakers here and for all you audience participating of our webinar. Thank you very much. Stay healthy. Goodbye.